Okay, so I'm going to talk about the spectral networks, locally connected network networks. Okay, so as we saw from the first talk today by Jeff, currently convolutional networks are getting very, very successful.
Oh, it's good. You should stand on this side if you want to be seen on camera.
Oh, okay. So convolutional networks are getting more and more challenges in speech and object recognition. And the reason why we can apply these convolutional networks to this sort of data is mainly that there are fundamentally three reasons. The first one is because the images and sounds are actually defined on a grid. So for images, it's like two-dimensional grid. For sounds, it's like a one-dimensional grid. And in this grid, signal processes are translation invariant. But the other reason why we can actually apply convolutional networks with a fixed size kernel is because the local statistics in these images, for images and for sound, actually are dominated. So what it means is that even if we want to learn more complex structures, we can do so by first learning local structures, local statistical structures, and then learning their in the parameters. So as a consequence, that the result is that the number of parameters that we need to learn in these networks is independent of the size of the image. Okay? And this is maybe one of the reasons why they are so successful in practice as opposed to fully connected networks. But of course, these things have limits. And we know that there are these properties we have on images and speech, but there are many, many other problems, many other domains in which we don't have these problems. For example, we think about the problems where we have to, let's say, do some recognition, some analysis of the surface tensions of these 3D meshes. Other example is let's suppose that we have already started from a spectrogram of the signal, okay, of the speech. Here we have a two-dimensional signal. But not necessarily the properties I said before, they are not necessarily translated in that case, because as you see, the harmonic structure in this speech is actually very important. So the correlation structure is not the same as when we have images. Other example, social networks, we can have data depending on these huge signals where we have no structure, or no geometric structure. And another example that is relevant that I want to mention is that even in the standard architecture where we have a lot of different layers, intermediate layers, they are still convolutional, but only on two of the dimensions. So what happens is that across the feature, there's no structure that we can exploit easily. And so we are essentially forced to learn convolutional kernels that are fully connected across the feature dimension. And so the question I will try to talk about, to address today, is in general, how can we define layers where the number of parameters is independent of the size of the image? Okay, so for this, the framework I will be using, of course, is to think about my signals as functions that depend on graphs. And here the graph, so every node in the graph corresponds to some coordinate, some feature. And what will be very important for us is the notion of similarity between different features. Okay, so this similarity can come either from the sensing process. For example, if we have images or we have like three-dimensional meshes, the distance between, we have some metric between different features that gives us the notion of similarity. But also, it can also be estimated from the data. And here there are some prior work by Benjamin and some of his co-authors, where if we just look at the like statistics across different features, by looking at very simple statistics like the second order, like the covariances, we are able to recover the notion of similarity between different features by just measuring covariances. And so this is something that has also been applied before, in 3 years ago. And so, once we have this notion of similarity, what can we do with that? So a very natural thing to do is starting with the notion of locally connected network. So what we are going to do is we just start with a graph. We can learn a bunch of different neighborhoods that somehow capture the local neighborhood structure, the local correlation structure. Once we have these neighborhoods, we can learn some linear, locally connected mapping, locally connected linear transformation. But then we can for each neighborhood some measurement, we can reduce the resolution of the graph, and then start it. We have a graph that has more resolution. We can do, we apply the same strategy. And so this, what it defines, is defines a network where at every layer, what we are going to do is we're going to learn like a transformation where the only ways that are allowed to be non-zero are the ones that correspond, that capture perspective on the Earth. And so this is something that we can construct by just estimating or constructing what's called a hierarchical clustering of curves, which is a problem that is pretty standard in graph theory and natural iceberg. But the problem is that this construction, as we have seen, in a sense, moves us from a fully connected layer to a layer that has lots of zeros. But still, we still need to construct. We still need to spend a number of parameters that somehow is proportional to the size of the intersection. So we have, in a sense, gone halfway. So the question is, can we go a bit further? Can we go a bit beyond this asymptotic regime? And so for this, we will look at the problem from a different angle. And so let's try to reinterpret what does it mean a convolution in practice. How can we redefine the convolution? So as you may know, convolutions can be defined through different ways. But one way that is going to be relevant for us is a look at whether the eigenvectors that diagonalize the convolution of right. And so as you know, convolution, if you look at the Fourier domain, it's just a diagonal operation. Okay. And so the diagonal operation in the Fourier domain. So Fourier for the Fourier frequency, the Fourier atoms are the convex expansion. So we can look at this basis that diagonalizes convolution also as emerging from a very fundamental operator. This is the Laplacian operator. So the Laplacian operator is an operator that somehow gives us the local irregularity of a function. Okay, so this Laplacian operator, actually, we can extend it, we can define it on a graph. And this is something that is a very standard theory that emerged that started like in the 50s, 60s. And so it's only everything I'm telling here is very, very classical. So what we have is we have an operator that is diagonalized by the Fourier eigenbasis. And this operator, now we can extend it, we can define it on a graph. And so the way we extend it on a graph is by means of what's called the Laplacian. Okay? And the Laplacian is just, if you look at what happens in coordinates, just takes a function on the graph and gives us the local variations of this function around the neighbor. So this is an operator that is symmetric, positive definite. So we can generalize it. So the basis that generalizes this operator somehow is the equivalent of the Fourier basis in the graph. So here I'll show you some examples on what are these eigenbasis of the Laplacian. So here you see that you recover something that reminds us of the sinus and cosinus bases in the grid. Because here we see sinus that are oscillating across different frequencies. Okay, so now that we have this basis, how can we use it to define our notion of convolution? So we are just going to follow the same like intuitive idea, the same thing that we have on the grid. We are just going to define a convolution, any linear operator that commutes with our plastic. In other words, as we have heard from the previous speaker right now, operators that commute is equivalent as operators that diagonalize in the same basis. So in that case, we have the basis that we have constructed from the Laplacian. So what we will define as a convolution is going to be diagonal in this case. So now, rather than learning the coefficients of our kernels in the spatial domain, we can learn them in the spectral domain. We can directly learn these coefficients that are expressed in this local. And so, of course, once we have this, we can define a filter bank by just learning different sets of diagonal coefficients. But again, what we have here is that the number of parameters that a priori we need to learn for each filter, is again the size of x, which is totally just for something that is. So, again, the same question, how can we do better? Okay, so here's an idea on a possible way how to make it better, is to look again at yet another property that is a very fundamental property of the Fourier analysis, is the fact that it gives us a very, very fundamental relationship analogy between two things that are very important, which is the decay of the signal and the regularity of its Fourier transform. So here we know what we have said before is that in convolutional networks, we are not only using convolutions, but convolutions with kernels that are very localized in space. So how can we achieve the same thing, but now looking at the global? So here's a I give you an example where I will see that this signal here is in space has a Fourier transform that has some irregularity. So as we localize this function in space, as we make the kernel more and more compact in space, what we see is that the Fourier transform becomes more and more stable. Okay, so this is an illustration of the property. So this this gives an idea. There's a burden of having to spend one parameter per frequency. What we'll do is we'll define an interpolation problem. So we will just learn filters that are smooth in the frequency domain. Okay, so, and actually, we can show that if we want to have a kernel that has an equivalent size that is compact, that is finite, actually what we have is that we only need to spend a number of that number of parameters that is proportional to the size of the world that we will use in practice. Okay, so this is the basic construction that gives us eventually the possibility to learn with a constant number of parameters. And but for this, there's a little subtle detail that somehow hides a very deep, very important question. Is that here I told you that we it's enough to take the spectrum and just smooth. But how can we smooth? The different frequencies, the frequency map. For smoothness, actually requires I need to give you who is neighbor. In order to smooth, we need to relate to something that depends on the relationship between different frequencies. So this is actually a problem that a priori we don't know how to relate to the different frequencies. But there's something that is sort of kind of surprising, at least to me, is that even if we start with a very, very, very naive way to organize the frequencies, we're just going to organize the frequencies according to their decay in the Laplace. So we're just going to consider the organization of the frequencies along a one-dimensional line. So when we are going to smooth the frequencies, we are just going to smooth them as if it was a one-dimensional scale. But this again is a construction that is that already gives us some good results in practice. But somehow the main problem of how to choose the similarities between frequencies so that we optimize this trade-off is a problem that is somehow open, and we are working on it, and we have some ideas on how to do it. But again, I want to see that this is a problem that is somehow the core, it's like the fundamental problem of this construction. Okay, so now I'll just show you some preliminary results that we have using this method. So here, what I consider two different examples that were variations of the techniques. In the first one, we took the NIST dataset, and we just removed randomly half of the pieces. Okay, so now we have signals that are defined in a sense on a subsample grid. Okay, so we have a grid that is not full. So now we have no notion of translation. We just have a graph, and in that case, we have a similarity that are given by the distance between the pixels. And so here we compare different constructions. Okay, so the first one is the construction that has is completely agnostic to the way these sensing are constructed. So it's a fully connected layer with two-layer fully connected network. And here we compare it with the two different constructions that describe. This is the construction that is the locally connected network. And this is the spectrum. So the first thing to see is that the number of parameters that we are spending on each of these networks is actually, there's a difference of another of magnitude in that case, and two orders of magnitude in the case of the spectrum. Here we see that this gain of this reduction in parameters actually doesn't have any impact on performance. I mean, we're even able to actually improve the performance by somehow making the network generalize better. Because somehow we are spending a much less number of parameters to learn essentially the same thing. So this is the first example. The other example is we took the LNAs and we project them on the 3D sphere. So that the way we projected them, of course, is that we chose a random point in the 3D sphere, a random orientation, and then we just did the projection. So this is a problem that is actually much harder than the original case, because of course we have all the problems of rotation and translation that have emerged in this case that you don't have in the original case. And here you can show the reason why this is actually a much harder problem by looking at the performance of a very naive classifier that is the nearest neighbor. Here it's like maybe 5 times more difficult than doing nearest neighbors in the original instance. So here again, I want to show you the result of the spectral construction. So here, somehow is a result that validates a little bit our hypothesis. So here are some of the learned feature maps with our spectral construction. So here the important thing to see is that we are able to actually to learn feature maps that are compact in space, that have all the energy here is concentrated in the original. So this is something that we have achieved by just introducing this idea of smoothing the eigenvalues. And And here the performance is very less clear. But here what we see is that also we are able to reduce by almost two orders of magnitude the number of parameters and still get a performance, that is actually equally or equally as having a full connected network. Okay, so I just want to I'm going to conclude. And so here what we showed is that we have a very first construction, a very first set of techniques that allow us to exploit the geometry of the data in order to learn with less number of parameters and having a network that has no assumptions. Okay, so and we saw that it's relatively easy to get a network that can exploit the law of geometry. But if you want to learn with a number of parameters that is somehow independent of the size, we also need to exploit the law of global geometry. And one way to do this is going through the spectrum. Okay? Going through the spectrum. But there are still a lot of things that we don't. There are still a lot of things that we don't understand. One thing that in particular is somehow a concern is that in this construction, a priori, we need to compute the Fourier transform. Okay? We need to compute the equivalent of the Fourier transform. But in that case, if we have no assumption, if the operation that is relatively expensive, especially if we compare it with the n-log-n transform, that as we saw yesterday in the poster, it seems to be a very efficient way to do convolutions in this field of maps. Okay, so this is an issue that we need to get a bit more. Of course, we still need to know how does it work in practice with large data sets, with graphs that are potentially much more irregular than these examples are abstracted. And as I said, there's also this question of how to actually place the frequencies in the dual domain, how to construct this dual graph. It's a domain that smoothing in that domain is going to give us filters that are well localized in the region. And just as an opening and some sort of a more like a qualitative comment, here I want to emphasize the point that what I think is important is this notion that in the data, in the original data, there's symmetries. There are some symmetries that can exist in the original data that, for example, are expressed, as I said, by saying that the signals are potentially invariant, that there might be other sort of relationships that we can discover from data. And somehow these symmetries, they need to be used, they can be exploited to design networks that efficiently allocate the parameters according to these symmetries. Okay, so this is just a very first step, a very humble step in that direction. But I think that there's still a lot to be done to how to actually solve this question of how to allocate the networks, the parameters, optimally by trying to exploit the symmetries. So this is everything I wanted to say, so I'm open for questions. Thank you.
Questions? Well, I guess I had one. So how does this scale with the size of the grind?
In computations, you have to actually compute the Fourier transform, so it's something that is the largest computation. But the second parameters, the last unit that doesn't scale. Yes?
There is a related paper that is pretty recent that they construct autoencoders using this connectivity structure to the rebound. So, do you think that these spectral networks have also some chance to get to true level bounds for certain types of data?
Well, it's a hard question, but as I said, it is. As I said, the local connectivity somehow it gives you halfway, and somehow here again the point of this work is to show that in millions of regimes this might be already too expensive, and so this and to go to the next step to have the same sort of asymptotic regime as the convolutional networks have, we need to actually go to the spectral domain, and so but then I maybe it's not the question that we can discuss online. I don't know this well, actually.
Yeah.
Yes?
So here, you talk about the graph here in terms of similarity of the,
of the object. Features.
So I just wonder, in many other applications where the graph can represent much richer type of relationship, for
yes.
example, you know, in a web search, people you
yes.
know, have
yes.
a click,
yes.
that kind of relationship is not measured in terms of similarity.
Well,
right?
So either
so
either
it's just a relation.
Yes, so either you can maybe given to you, so you don't need to learn it. And in that case, you can already apply, and you have the graph already, so you can define the network straight away. But there are some, as I said, there are some contexts in which you just have like a, let's say, a measurement, because you have different features, and you know that they are not completely independent, but you know that there's not the statistical dependencies of the features are not just fully connected. So there are some features that are more related to others. And in that case, should you actually try to learn a fully connected layer that tries to put away across any pair or any connection? Or can you exploit, can you capitalize on the fact that there are only a small number of connections that matter to learn with less number of parameters and so better analyze them?
So your conclusion is that even for the graph,
yes,
like social net graph,
yes,
where you know people connect, which doesn't have to be measured in terms of similarity, that technique may still apply.
Yes, yes,
okay.
Thank you.
Yes.
Okay, well, thank you, John.